Hello everyone, my name is Froy and today we're going to talk about the Epic of Gilgamesh. Gilgamesh is an epic poem from ancient Mesopotamia that is often regarded as the oldest surviving work of literature. The oldest versions of the tale are believed to be written around 2100 BC.
These oldest versions survive in five loose Sumerian fragments written on clay tablets. Unfortunately, large parts of these oldest versions have gone missing or are so badly damaged that they are unreadable. The story lingered on orally for hundreds of years until a scribe named Seneleki Uniki around 1500 BC composed an Akkadian version of the Gilgamesh epic. And it's this version that is often seen as a standard version, and most modern translations are also based on his work.
So what is this story about? It follows the story of Gilgamesh, the mythological hero king of the city of Uruk, and his half-wild friend Enkidu as they undertake a series of dangerous adventures together.
The story begins with the introduction of Gilgamesh, king of Uruk, two-thirds god and one-third human, blessed by the gods with strength, courage and beauty, and the strongest and greatest king who ever existed. The great city of Uruk is also praised for its glory and its strong brick walls. However, the people of Uruk are not happy and complain that Gilgamesh is too harsh and abuses his power by sleeping with their women. The goddess of creation, Aruru, creates a mighty wild man named Enkidu, a rival in strength to Gilgamesh. He lives a natural life with the wild animals, but he soon starts bothering the shepherds and trappers of the area, and jostles the animals at the watering hole. At the request of a trapper, Gilgamesh sends a temple prostitute, Shamat, to seduce and tame Enkidu, and after 6 days and seven nights with her, he is no longer just a wild beast who lives with the animals. He soon learns the ways of men and is shunned by the animals he used to live with, and the harlot eventually persuades him to come to live in the city. Meanwhile, Gilgamesh has some strange dreams, which his mother, Ninsun, explains as an indication that a mighty friend will come to him. The newly civilized Enkidu enters the city of Uruk, where he learns to help the local shepherds and trappers in their work. One day, when Gilgamesh himself comes to a wedding party to sleep with the bride, he finds his way blocked by the mighty Enkidu, who opposes Gilgamesh's ego, his treatment of women, and the defamation of the sacred bonds of marriage. Enkidu and Gilgamesh fight each other, and after a mighty battle, Gilgamesh defeats Enkidu, but breaks off from the fight and spares his life. He also begins to heed what Enkidu has said and to learn the virtues of mercy and humility. Both Gilgamesh and Enkidu are transformed for the better through their newfound friendship and have many lessons to learn from each other. In time, they begin to see each other as brothers and become inseparable. Years later, bored with a peaceful life in Uruk and wanting to make an everlasting name for himself, Gilgamesh proposes to travel to the sacred cedar forest to cut some great trees and kill the guardian, the demon Humbaba. Enkidu objects to the plan as the cedar forest is a sacred realm of the gods and not meant for mortals, but neither Enkidu nor the council of elders of Uruk can convince Gilgamesh not to go. Gilgamesh's mother also complains about the quest, but eventually gives in and asks the sun god Shamash for his support. She also gives Enkidu some advice and adopts him as her second son. On the way to the cedar forest, Gilgamesh has some bad dreams. But each time, Enkidu manages to explain away the dreams as good omens, and he encourages and urges Gilgamesh on when he becomes afraid again on reaching the forest. Finally, the two heroes confront Humbaba, the demon ogre guardian of the sacred trees, and a great battle commences. And with the help of the wind sent by the sun god Shamash, Humbaba is defeated. The monster begs Gilgamesh for his life, and Gilgamesh at first pities the creature, despite Enkidu's practical advice to kill the beast. Humbaba then curses them both, and Gilgamesh finally puts an end to it. Sometime later, the goddess Ishtar, goddess of love and war and daughter of the sky god Anu, makes sexual advances to Gilgamesh, but he rejects her. The offended Ishtar insists that her father sends the bull of heaven to avenge Gilgamesh's rejection, threatening to raise the dead if he will not comply. The beast brings with it a great drought and plague of the land. But Gilgamesh and Enkidu, this time without divine help, slay the beast and offer its heart to Shamash, throwing the bull's hindquarters in the face of the outraged Ishtar. The city of Uruk celebrates the great victory, but Enkidu has a bad dream in which the gods decide to punish Enkidu himself for the killing of the bull of heaven and Humbaba. He curses the door he made for the gods, and he curses the trapper he met, the harlot he loved, and the very day that he became human. However, he regrets his curses when Shamash speaks from heaven and points out how unfair Enkidu is being. He also points out that Gilgamesh will become but a shadow of his former self if Enkidu were to die, Nevertheless, the curse takes hold, and day after day Enkidu becomes more and more ill. As he dies, he describes his descent into the horrific dark underworld, the House of Dust, where the dead wear feathers like birds and eat clay. Gilgamesh is devastated by Enkidu's death, and offers gifts to the gods in the hope that he might be allowed to walk beside Enkidu in the underworld. He orders the people of Uruk, from the lowest farmer to the highest temple priest, to also mourn Enkidu, and orders statues of Enkidu to be built. Gilgamesh is so full of grief and sorrow over his friend that he refuses to leave Enkidu's side or allow his corpse to be buried until 6 days and seven nights after his death, when maggots begin to fall from his body. Gilgamesh is determined to avoid Enkidu's fate and decides to make the perilous journey to visit Utnapishtim and his wife, the only humans who have survived the Great Flood and who were granted immortality by the gods, in the hope of discovering the secret everlasting life. The ageless Utnapishtim and his wife now reside in a beautiful country in another world, and Gilgamesh travels far to the east in search for them, crossing great rivers and oceans and grappling and slaying monstrous mountain lions, bears and other beasts. Eventually he comes to the twin peaks of Mount Mashu at the end of the earth, from where the sun rises from the other world, the gate of which is guarded by two terrible scorpion beings. They allow Gilgamesh to proceed when he convinces them of his divinity, and he travels for 12 leagues through the dark tunnel where the sun travels every night. The world at the end of the tunnel is a bright wonderland full of trees with leaves of jewels. The first person Gilgamesh meets there is a winemaker Siduru, who initially believes he is a murderer from his disheveled appearance and attempts to dissuade him from his quest. But eventually she sends him to Ushnabi, the ferryman who must help him across the sea to the island where Utnapishtim lives. Finally, they reach the island of Dilmun, and when Utnapishtim sees that there is someone else in the boat, he asks Gilgamesh who he is. Gilgamesh tells him his story and asks Utnapishtim if he can get immortal as well, but Utnapishtim is reluctant and he challenges Gilgamesh to see if he can beat sleep first. So he challenges Gilgamesh to stay awake for 6 days and seven nights, and Utnapishtim tells him the story of how he survived the Great Flood. Utnapishtim recounts how a great storm and flood was brought to the world by the god Enlil, who wanted to destroy all of mankind for the noise and confusion they brought to the world. But the god Ea forewarned Utnapishtim, advising him to build a ship in readiness and to load onto it his treasures, his family and the seeds of all living things. The rains came as promised and the whole world was covered with water, killing everything except Utnapishtim and his boat. The boat came to rest on the tip of the mountain of Nisir, where they waited for the waters to subside, releasing first a dove, then a swallow, and then a raven to check for dry land. Utnapishtim then made sacrifices and libations to the gods, and although Enlil was angry that someone had survived his flood, Ea advised him to make his peace. So Enlil blessed Utnapishtim and his wife and granted them everlasting life, and took them to live in the land of the gods on the islands of Dilmun. But Gilgamesh falls asleep almost before Utnapishtim finishes speaking. When he awakes after 7 days of sleep, Utnapishtim ridicules his failure and sends him back to Uruk. As they leave though, Utnapishtim's wife asks her husband to have mercy on Gilgamesh for his long journey, and so he tells Gilgamesh of a plant that grows at the very bottom of the ocean that will make him young again. Gilgamesh obtains the plant by binding stones to his feet to allow him to walk on the bottom of the sea. He plans to use the flower to rejuvenate the old man of the city of Uruk and then to use it for himself. Unfortunately, he places the plant on the shore of a lake while he bathes, and it is stolen by a serpent, which loses its old skin and is thus reborn. Gilgamesh weeps at having failed at both opportunities to obtain immortality, and he disconsolately returns to the massive walls of his own city of Uruk. In time, Gilgamesh too dies, and the people of Uruk mourn his passing, knowing that they will never see his like again.
The influence of Mesopotamian stories like Gilgamesh on European culture is often underestimated. For example, one of the most prominent stories in the Bible, that of the story of the flood and the Ark of Noah, has roots in much, much older stories found in Mesopotamia. Already thousands of years before the story of Noah was written, we find a story about Utnapishti in Mesopotamia, who had to build an ark because a purging storm was about to kill the sinful human race. I think it is fascinating to see that many stories found in the Bible, but also in the Quran, in ancient Greek or Latin, all of their roots in much, much older stories found in Mesopotamia.
Mesopotamia is the unknown and mysterious forefather of all civilizations around the Mediterranean. But how mighty the Mesopotamian culture might have been in antiquity, after thousands of years, people started to forget about this sublime culture and tales like Gilgamesh passed out of all knowledge, until in the 19th century clay tablets were excavated in Iraq. In 1849, the Epic of Gilgamesh was rediscovered in the library of Ashurbanipal, but it took over 20 years until the mysterious scripts were translated. The cuneiform script in which the Akkadian literature was written is very ambiguous and exceptionally difficult to read. Only a few people in the world are capable to translate the clay tablets. Also, it should be noted that there does not exist one full or standard version of the Epic of Gilgamesh. The clay tablets come in loose and damaged fragments, so the scholars have to puzzle the pieces together in order to form one complete story. But it seems that there circulated quite different versions of Gilgamesh in Mesopotamia. Many clay tablets tell a somewhat different story than others. One reason why this is the case might be that, as literature was mostly produced orally, every narrator or bard had his own personal version of the tale, which he knew by heart.
In general, it is difficult to maintain one standard version of a tale if there is no quick and easy way to internalize it. Of course, I could write it down, but that takes a very long time and only a very small portion of society could read. So that's it for this video. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. Have a nice day.